20 years old. My mother had to sign the contract because I wasn't legally old enough, state of Michigan. So we're young guys, garage band out of Flint, Michigan, and I'm standing in front of 180,000 people in Atlanta, Georgia for our first gig. It was big right from the get, and then when Capitol signed us and the record started selling, we sold out Chase Stadium faster than the Beatles. I mean, all that stuff kind of, you know, puffed me up. But I got a good grip on it because I come from good stock, brother. In our case, because I had to play all the time, 100% of the time, in order to, you know, to make it work on stage. And the holes, when I would go to take a lead, as you mentioned, you know, then you'd have the hole. But that hole opening up is what gave the magic to every three-piece group. And that was kind of, you know, it put us alongside of some pretty good stepped-up people. I mean, Hendrix was my guitar god. You know, when we were in the studio, we would be listening back to takes, and if there was a fudge in there, you know, somebody hit a clam, but the thing was good, the take felt good, we'd just say, screw it, let's take it with three pieces. When we discussed this, I mean, prior to this becoming a three-piece group, we had five pieces. I wasn't even playing. I was stand-up, a singer, front man, and we had a guitar player, bass player, keyboard player, and drums. But we got stranded out in Cape Cod. We were out doing some dates in the winter, and they put us in these summer cottages on Cape Cod, and then the worst snowstorm in history hit, and a little tiny space heater just in the living room only. The pipes froze. It was bad. We were stranded, and two of these guys were married. And so when we got back to Michigan, of course, their wives were going through the roof, and they were threatening divorce and everything. I looked at Brewer, and I said, dude, we got to put a band together, and it doesn't have any women involved. You know, nobody's married. Oh, most definitely. So that was our right. Inspiration to get three-piece and to go three-piece, and then we were going to go up to Bay City to give these guys from the promotion company a piece of our mind, because they stuck it to us, and we're sitting in the waiting room to get into this office, and there is a facility where, you know, they had several bands in there and stages and stuff, and somebody was rehearsing, and I said to Brewer, I said, listen to that bass player, dude. Whoever that is, they're playing the shit out of that thing, you know? And so when they took a break, well, Mel Shocker, you know, Grand Funk bass player, he stepped out, and I said, Mel, I can't believe that you in there, man. And I said, no wonder it's a good bass, because I played music with this guy before and jammed, and I really love this style. And then I told him, I said, Brewer and I are going to put together a three-piece band. Would you be interested? He says, man, I am so ready to leave ? And the Mysterians, who he's playing bass with, or at the time, and who we were listening to, you know, through the wall, said, I will be there. So we started rehearsal the next week. And when we started, it was kind of strange without other instruments, just three-piece. But Mel, you know, he had this kind of a fuzzy sound. I said, man, if we could get that and capture that, we can, you know, it'll push me. And I believe that we can get that under the music. And, of course, Terry Knight, a producer, he's also our manager, but he produced all that early stuff. and he put the bass in your face. He was the first guy, and you know, and Mel walked on stage and just go to the amplifier, and he'd just run his hand across the top of the knobs and turn everything to 10. And he would melt down, you know, KT-88s, a match pair of KT-88. He would be pumping that thing so hard, and then we'd look back, and a puff of smoke come out. They'd throw another amplifier up there. Oh, man, it was, you know, that space that you're talking about, Jake, that's the fat of the sound
right,
to me.
Right,
it really is. And because we were able to somehow, you know, transition into three-piece, because I'd always been in at least four-piece, and we missed it for about 5 minutes. And then we were like, man, this is sounding good. And, you know, we've encouraged each other. And I had always, I dug, you know, because I was a dancer back then. My sister and I would go to the dance contest at the National Guard Armory in Flint, Michigan, and we'd win. You know, my mom got us into dancing early on, and I was not shy about, you know, dancing, and part of that is still in my act, my stage act today. I love to dance, and I dance with a guitar on. So that was another thing, you know, visually that helped us get through. And also, I would hit like a high note, a real high note, and this is before Grand Funk. I'm listening and I'm watching people, and people are just like walking around, but when I would hit a high note, everybody would turn their head. I'm going, okay, I'm going to hit more high notes. And, dude, I started singing in the stratosphere, and people would come to the stage.
Right.
It was like I was calling them in, you know, so that we had that working. And Brewer could sing, and I could sing. Mel, he couldn't carry a tune in a dump truck, but he could play the shit out of that bass, you know.
Thank you.